Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Delta Wedding by Eudora Welty, narrated by Sally Darling. This book is copyrighted 1945 and 1946 by Eudora Welty. This recording is copyrighted 1994 by Recorded Books. Eudora Welty was born in Jackson, Mississippi in 1909. Her novels and short stories are pictures of people and life in the Deep South, exploring the mysteries of the separateness of individuals and her belief that in each life is a piece of all life. Considered one of the South's finest writers, she won the Pulitzer Prize in 1972. Delta Wedding is her first novel and best-known work. And now, Delta Wedding.
Chapter 1. The nickname of the train was the Yellow Dog. Its real name was the Yazoo Delta. It was a mixed train. The day was the 10th of September, 1923. Afternoon. Laura McRaven, who was 9 years old, was on her first journey alone. She was going up from Jackson to visit her mother's people, the Fairchilds, at their plantation named Shell Mound at Fairchilds, Mississippi. When she got there, poor Laura, little motherless girl, they would all run out and say, for her mother had died in the winter, and they had not seen Laura since the funeral. Her father had come as far as Yazoo City with her and put her on the dog. Her cousin, Dabney Fairchild, who was 17, was going to be married. But Laura could not be in the wedding for the reason that her mother was dead. Of these facts, the one most persistent in Laura's mind was the most intimate one, that her age was 9. In the passenger car, every window was propped open with a stick of kindling wood. A breeze blew through, hot and then cool, fragrant of the woods and yellow flowers, and of the train. The yellow butterflies flew in at any window, out at any other, and outdoors one of them could keep up with the train, which then seemed to be racing with a butterfly. Overhead, a black lamp in which a circle of flowers had been cut out swung round and round on a chain as the car rocked from side to side, sending down dainty drifts of kerosene smell. The dog was almost sure to reach Fairchilds before the lamp would be lighted by Mr. Terry Black, the conductor, who had promised her father to watch out for her. Laura had the seat facing the stove, but of course no fire was burning in it now. She sat leaning at the window, the light and the sooty air trying to make her close her eyes. Her ticket to Fairchilds was stuck up in her Madge Evans straw hat, in imitation of the drummer across the aisle. Once the dog stopped in the open fields, and Laura saw the engineer, Mr. Doolittle, go out and pick some specially fine goldenrod there. For whom, she could not know. Then the long September cry rang from the thousand unseen locusts, urgent at the open windows of the train. Then at one place a white foxy farm dog ran beside the yellow dog for a distance just under Laura's window, barking sharply. And then they left him behind, or he turned back. And then, as if a hand reached along the green ridge and all of a sudden pulled down with a sweep, like a scoop in the bin, the hill and every tree in the world, and left cotton fields. The Delta began. The drummer, with a groan, sank into sleep. Mr. Terry Black walked by and took the tickets out of their hats. Laura brought up her saved banana, peeled it down, and bit into it. Thoughts went out of her head, and the landscape filled it. In the Delta, Most of the world seemed sky. The clouds were large, larger than horses or houses, larger than boats or churches or gins, larger than anything except the fields the Fairchilds planted. Her nose in the banana skin, as in the cup of a lily, she watched the delta. The land was perfectly flat and level, but it shimmered like the wing of a lighted dragonfly. It seemed strummed, as though it were an instrument, and something had touched it. Sometimes in the cotton were trees with one, two, or three arms. She could draw better trees than those were. Sometimes, like a fuzzy caterpillar, looking in the cotton, was a winding line of thick green willows and cypresses. And when the train crossed this green, running on a loud iron bridge, down its center, like a golden mark on the caterpillar's back, would be a bayou. When the day lengthened, a rosy light lay over the cotton. Laura stretched her arm out the window and let the soot sprinkle it. There went a black mule. In the diamond light of far distance, going into the light, a child drove a black mule home, and all behind, the hidden track through the fields was marked by the lifted, fading train of dust. The delta buzzards, that seemed to wheel as wide and high as the sun, with evening were going down too, settling into faraway violet tree stumps for the night. In the delta, the sunsets were reddest light. The sun went down lopsided and wide as a rose on a stem in the west, and the west was a milk-white edge like the foam of the sea. The sky, the field, the little track, and the bayou, over and over. All that had been bright or dark was now one color. From the warm window sill, the endless fields glowed like a hearth in firelight, and Laura, looking out, leaning on her elbows with her head between her hands, felt what an arriver in a land feels. That slow, hard pounding in the breast. Fairchilds! Fairchilds! Mr. Terry Black lifted down the suitcase Laura's father had put up in the rack. The dog ran through an iron bridge over James's bayou and past a long, twilighted gin, its tin side looking first like a blue lake, and a platform where cotton bales were so close they seemed to lean out to the train. Behind it, dark gold and shadowy, was the river, the Yazoo. They came to the station, the dark yellow color of goldenrod, and stopped. Through the windows, Laura could see five or six cousins at once, all jumping up and down at different moments. Each mane of light hair waved like a holiday banner, so that you could see the Fairchilds everywhere. Even with everybody meeting the train and asking Mr. Terry how he had been since the day before. When Mr. Terry set her on the little iron steps, holding her square doll suitcase, in which her doll Marmion was horizontally suspended, and gave her a spank, she staggered and was lifted down among flying arms to the earth. "Kiss Blewett!" The baby was put in her face. She was kissed and laughed at, and her hat would have been snatched away but for the new elastic that pulled it back. And then she was half carried along like a drunken reveler at a festival, not quite recognizing who anyone was. India hadn't come. We couldn't find her. And Dabney hadn't come. She was going to be married. They piled her into the Studebaker, into the little folding seat, with Ranny reaching sections of an orange into her mouth from where he stood behind her. Where were her suitcases? They drove rattling across the Yazoo Bridge and whirled through the shady, river-smelling street where the town, Fairchild store and all, looked like a row of dark barns, while the boys sang Abdul the Bulbul Amir, or shouted, "Let Blewett drive!" and the baby was handed over Laura's head and stood between Arin's knees proudly. Arin was 14, a wonderful driver. They went up and down the street 3 times, backing into cotton fields to turn around, before they went across the bridge again homeward.
"That's to Marmion," said Arin to Laura kindly.
He waved at an old track that did not cross the river but followed it, 2 purple ruts in the strip of wood shadow.
"Marmion's my dolly," she said. "It's not, it's where I was born," said Arin.
There was no use in Laura and Arin talking any more about what anything was. On this side of the river were the gin and compress, the railroad track, the forest-filled cemetery where her mother was buried in the Fairchild lot, the old Methodist church with the steamboat bell glinting pink in the light, and Brunswick town, where the Negroes were, smoking now on every doorstep. Then the car traveled in its cloud of dust like a blind being through the fields, one after the other, like all one field. But Laura knew they had names, the Mound Field and Moon Field after Moon Lake. When they were as far as the overseer's house, Laura saw all the cousins lean out and spit, and she did too.
"I thought you all liked Mr. Bascom," she said after they got by. "It's not Mr. Bascom now, crazy," they said. "Is it, Blewett? Not Mr. Bascom now."
Then the car crossed the little bayou bridge, whose rackety rhythm she remembered, and there was Shell Mound. Facing James's bayou, back under the planted pecan grove, it was gently glowing in the late summer night, the brightest thing in the evening. The tall, white, wide frame house with a porch all around, its bayed tower on one side, its tinted windows open, and its curtains stirring, and even from here plainly to be heard a song coming out of the music room, played on the piano by a stranger to Laura. They curved in at the gate. All the way up the drive, the boy cousins, with a shout, would jump and spill out and pick up a ball from the ground and throw it rocket-like. By the carriage block in front of the house, Laura was pulled out of the car and held by the hand. Shelley had hold of her, the oldest girl. Laura did not know if she had been in the car with her or not. Shelley had her hair still done up long, parted in the middle, and a ribbon around it low across her brow and knotted behind like a chariot racer. She wore a fountain pen on a chain now, and had her initials done in runny ink on her tennis shoes, over the ankle bones. Inside the house, the piece all at once ended.
"Shelley!" someone called imploringly.
"Dabney is an example of madness on earth," said Shelley now, and then she ran off, trailed by Blewett, beating plaintively on a drum found in the grass with a little stick. The boys were scattered like magic. Laura was deserted. Grass softly touched her legs and her garter rosettes, growing sweet and springy, for this was the country. On the narrow little walk along the front of the house, hung over with closing lemon lilies, there was a quieting and vanishing of sound. It was not yet dark. The sky was the color of violets, and the snow-white moon in the sky had not yet begun to shine. Where it hung above the water tank, back of the house, the swallows were circling busy as the spinning of a top. By the flaky front steps, a thrush was singing water-like notes from the sweet olive tree, which was in flower. It was not too dark to see the breast of the thrush, or the little white blooms either. Laura remembered everything, with the fragrance and the song. She looked up the steps through the porch, where there was a wooden scroll on the screen door that her finger knew how to trace, and lifted her eyes to an old fanlight,
now reflecting a skylight as of a past summer, that she had been dared, oh, by Maureen, to throw a stone through, and had not. She dropped her suitcase in the grass and ran to the backyard and jumped up with two of the boys on the joggling board. In between Roy and Little Battle, she jumped, and the delights of anticipation seemed to shake her up and down. She remembered, as one remembers first the eyes of a loved person, the old blue water cooler on the back porch. How thirsty she always was here. Among the round and square wooden tables, always piled with snap beans, turnip greens, and onions from the day's trip to Greenwood. And while you drank, your eyes were on this green place here in the backyard, the joggling board, the neglected greenhouse, Aunt Ellen's guineas in the old buggy, the stable wall, elbow deep in a vine. And in the parlor she knew was a clover-shaped footstool covered with rose velvet where she would sit, and sliding doors to the music room that she could open and shut. In the halls would be the rising smell of girls' fudge cooking, the sound of the phone by the roll-top desk going unanswered. She could remember mostly the dining room, the paintings by great-aunt Meshula that was dead, of full-blown yellow roses and a watermelon split to the heart by a jackknife, and every ornamental plate around the rail different, because painted by a different aunt at a different time. The big table never quite cleared, the innumerable packs of old, old playing cards. She could remember India's paper dolls coming out flatter from the law books than hers from a shoebox, and smelling as if they were scorched from it. She remembered the Negroes, Bitsy, Roxy, Little Uncle, and Violet. She put out her arms like wings and knew in her fingers the thready pattern of red roses in the carpet on the stairs, and she could hear the high-pitched calls and answers going up the stairs and down. She thought of the upstairs hall, where it was twilight all the time from the green shadow of an awning, and where an old lopsided baseball lay all summer in a silver dish on the lid of the paper-crammed plantation desk, and how away at either end of the hall was a balcony, and the little square butterflies that flew so high were going by, and the June bugs knocking. She remembered the sleeping porches full of late sleepers, some strangers to her always among them, when India led her through and showed them to her. She remembered well the cotton lint on ceilings and lampshades, fresh every morning like a present from the fairies, that made Violet moan. Little Battle crowded her a little as he jumped, and she had to move down the board a few inches. They could play an endless game of hide-and-seek in so many rooms, and up and down the halls that intersected and turned into dead-end porches, and rooms full of wax begonias and elephant's ears, or rooms full of trunks. She remembered the nights, the moon vine, the ever-blooming Cape jessamines, the verbena smelling under running feet, the lateness of dancers. A dizziness rose in Laura's head, and Roy crowded her now, but she jumped on, keeping in with their rhythm. She remembered life in the undeterminate number of other rooms going on around her and India, where they lay in bed, life not stopping for a moment in deference to children going to sleep, but filling with later and later laughter, with Uncle Battle reciting, "Break, break, break!" The phone ringing its two longs and a short for the Fairchilds. Aunt Mac reading the Bible aloud. Was she dead yet? The visiting planters arguing with Uncle Battle and her other uncle, Uncle George, from dining room to library to porch. Aunt Ellen slipping by in the hall looking for something or someone. The distant silvery creak of the porch swing by night.
like a frog's voice. There would be little Ranny crying out in his dream, and the winding of the Victrola, and then a song called I Wish I Could Shimmy Like My Sister Kate, or Uncle Pink's favorite, Where Was He? Sir Harry Lauder singing Stop Your Ticklin', Jock. The girls that were old enough, dressed in colors called jade and flamingo, danced with each other around the dining room table until the boys came to get them, and could be watched from the upper landing, cavorting below like marvelous mermaids down a transparent sea. In bed, Laura and India would slap mosquitoes and tell each other things. Last summer, India had told Laura the showboat that came on the high water and the same old rabbit's foot minstrel as always. And Laura told India Babes in the Wood, Thurston the Magician, Annette Kellerman in Daughter of the Gods, and Clara Kimball Young in Drums of Jeopardy. And if Laura went off to sleep, India would choke her. She remembered the baying of the dogs at night, and how Roy believed when you heard the dogs bay, a convict had got out of parchment and they were after him in the swamp. Every night of the world the dogs would bay, and Roy would lie somewhere in the house, shaking in his bed. Just then, with a last move down the joggling board, Roy edged Laura off. She ran back to the steps and picked up her suitcase again. Then her heart pounded. India came abruptly around the house, bathed and dressed, busily watering the verbena in the flower bed out of a doll's cream pitcher, one drop to each plant. India, too, was 9. Her hair was all spun out down her back, and she had a blue ribbon in it. Laura touched her own Buster Brown hair, tangled now beyond anyone's help. Their white dresses, Laura's in the suitcase, folded by her father, and for a man to fold anything suddenly nearly killed her, were still identical. India had blue insertion run in the waist now, and Laura had white. But the same little interlocking three hoops were briar-stitched in the yokes, and their identical gold lockets still banged there against their chests. "My mother is dead," said Laura. India looked around at her and said, "Greeny!" Laura took a step back. "We never did unjoin," said India. "Greeny!" "All right," Laura said. "Owe you something." She stooped and put a pinch of grass in her shoe. "You have to wash now," said India. She added, looking in her pitcher, "Here's you a drop of water." All of a sudden, Maureen ran out from under the pecan trees, the cousin who was funny in her head, though it was not her fault. Besides her own fine clothes, she got India's dresses that she wanted, and India's ribbons, and India said she would get them till she died. She had never talked plain. Every word was two words to her, and had an L in it. Now she ran in front of Laura and straddled the walk at the foot of the steps. She danced from side to side with her arms spread, chanting, "Cullen Lala, can I get la by?" She was 9, too. Roy and Little Battle ran up blandly as if they had never let Laura joggle with them at all, giving no recognition. Orin walked tall as a man up from the bayou with a live fish he must have just caught, jumping on a string. He waved it at little Ranny, who at that moment rode out the front door and down the steps standing on the back of his tricycle, like Ben Hur, a towel tied around his neck and flying behind him. The dinner bell was ringing inside over and over the way Roxy rang, like an insistence against disbelief. Laura, avoiding sight of the fish, avoiding India's little drop, and Ranny and Maureen, made her way up the steps. Just as she reached the top, she threw up. There she waited, like a little dog. But Aunt Ellen, though she was late for everything, was now running out the screen door with open arms. She was the mother of them all. Something fell behind her, her apron, as she came, and she was as breathless as any of her children. Now she knelt and held Laura very firmly. "Laura, poor little motherless girl," she said. When Laura lifted her head, she kissed her. She sent India for a wringing wet cloth. Laura put her head on Aunt Ellen's shoulder and sank her teeth in the thick Irish lace on the collar of her white voile dress, which smelled like sweet peas. She hugged her and touched her forehead, the steady head held so near to hers, with its flying soft hair and its erect bearing of gentle, explicit, but unfathomed alarm. With the cool on her face, she could see clearer and clearer, though it was almost dark now, the pearl-edged side comb so hazardously bringing up the strands of Aunt Ellen's dark hair. She let her go, and if she could, she would have smoothed and patted her aunt's hair and cleared the pot with her own fingers and said, "Aunt Ellen, you must never mind." But of course she couldn't. Then she jumped up and ran after Orin into the house, beating India to the table. "Where's Uncle George?" Laura asked, looking from Uncle Battle around to everybody at the long, broad table. At supper time, since she had come, she was expecting to see everybody gathered. But Uncle George and his wife, Aunt Robbie, wouldn't drive in from Memphis until tomorrow. Aunt Tempy and her husband Uncle Pink Summers and their daughter Mary Dennis's little girl, Lady Claire Buchanan, were not driving over from Inverness until Mary Dennis had her baby. And the two aunts from the Grove, Aunt Primrose and Aunt Jim Allen, had not come up to supper tonight. There was just Uncle Battle's and Aunt Ellen's family of children at the table, besides, of course, the two great-aunts, Great-Aunt Shannon and Great-Aunt Mac, and Cousin Maureen, who lived here with them, and only one visitor, Dabney's best friend, Mary Lamar Mackey of Lookback Plantation. It was she who played the piano.
"Skeeter, next,"
called Uncle Battle resoundingly, fixing his eye on Laura. She passed her plate up to him. Uncle Battle, her mother's brother, with his corrugated brow, his planter's boots creaking under the table when he stood to carve the turkeys, was so tremendous that he always called children Skeeter. His thick, fair hair over his bulging brow had been combed with water before he came to the table, exactly like Orin's, Roy's, Little Battle's, and Ranny's. As his eye roved over them, Laura remembered that he had broken every child at the table now from being left-handed. Laura was ever hopeful that she would see Uncle Battle, the fire-eater, take up some fire and eat it, and thought it would be some night at supper.
"How Annie Laurie would have loved this very plate," Uncle Battle said softly just now, holding up Laura's serving. "Breast, gizzard, and wing. Pass it, boy."
Even cutting up the turkeys at the head of his table, he was a rushing, mysterious, very laughing man to have had so many children coming up busy, too. And he could put on a tender, irresponsible air, as if he were asking ladies and little girls, "Look at me. What can I do? Such a thing it all is." And he meant life, although he could also mention death and people's absence in an ordinary way. It was his habit to drive quickly off from the house at any time of the day or night, in a buggy or a car now. Automobiles had come in just as Uncle Battle got too heavy to ride his horse. He rode out to see work done or trouble helped. Sometimes trouble came at night.
When Negroes clear to Greenwood, cut each other up. It was well known that it took Uncle Battle to protect them from the sheriff, or prevail on a bad one to come out and surrender.
"Now eat it all,"
Uncle Battle called to her as the plate reached her. But it was a joke, he's giving her the gizzard, she saw, for it was her mother that loved it, and she couldn't stand that piece of turkey. She didn't dare tell him what he knew. "Where is Dabney?" she asked, for it was Dabney they had been talking about ever since they sat down to the table, and her place by her father was empty. "She'll be down directly," said Aunt Ellen. "She's going to be married, you know, Laura." "Tonight?" asked Laura.
"Oh," groaned Uncle Battle. "Oh, oh."
He always groaned three times. "Where is her husband now?" Laura asked. "Now don't, Battle," said Aunt Ellen anxiously. "Laura naturally wants to know how soon Dabney will marry Troy." "Not till Saturday, dear." "This is only Monday," Laura told her uncle consolingly. "Oh, Papa's really proud of Dabney, no matter how he groans, because she won't wait till cotton picking's over," said Shelley. She was sitting beside Laura and looked so seriously even at her that the black grosgrain ribbon crossing her forehead almost indented it.
"I am I?" said Battle. "Suppose you help your mother serve the pickled peaches at your end."
When Laura looked at her plate, the gizzard was gone. She almost jumped to her feet. She almost cried to think of all that had happened to her. Next, she was afraid she had eaten that bite without thinking. But then she saw Great Aunt Shannon calmly eating the gizzard on the other side of her. She had stolen it. Great Aunt Shannon, who would talk conversationally with Uncle Dennis and Aunt Rowena and Great Uncle George, who had all died no telling how long ago, that she thought were at the table with her. But just now, after eating a little bit of something, the gizzard and a biscuit or so, "No more than a bird," they protested, she was escorted by Orrin up to bed without saying a word. Great Aunt Mac glared after her. Great Aunt Mac wasn't dead at all.
"Now be ashamed of yourself," she called after her, "for starving yourself."
The boys all looked at each other, and even unwillingly they let smiles break out on their faces. The four boys were all ages. Orrin, older than Laura, Roy, Little Battle, and Ranny, younger, and constantly seeking one another, even at the table with their eyes, seeking the girls only for their audience when they hadn't one another. They were always rushing, chasing, flying, getting hurt. Only eating and the knot of their napkins could keep them in chairs. All their knickerbockers and Ranny's rompers had fresh holes for Aunt Ellen in both knees every evening. They ate turkey until they bit their fingers and cried, "Ouch!" They were so filled with their energy that once when Laura saw some old map on the wall with the blowing winds in the corners, mischievous-eyed and round cheeks, blowing the ships and dolphins around Scotland, Laura had asked her mother if they were India's four brothers. She loved them dearly. It was strange that it was India who had to be Laura's favorite cousin, since she would have given anything if the boy cousins would let her love them most. Of course, she expected them to fly from her side like birds and light on the joggling board, as they had done when she arrived, and to edge her off when she climbed up with them. That changed nothing. The boys were only like all the Fairchilds, but it was the boys and the men that defined that family always. All the girls knew it. When she looked at the boys and the men, Laura was without words, but she knew that company like a dream that comes back again and again, each aspect familiar and longing not to be forgotten.
great-great-Uncle George on his horse, in his portrait in the parlor, the one who had been murdered by the robbers on the Natchez Trace, and buried, horse, bridle, himself and all, on his way to the wilderness to be near great-great-grandfather. Even he, she had learned by looking up at him, had the family trait of quick, upturning smiles, instant comprehension of the smallest eddy of life in the current of the day, which would surely be entered in a kind of reckless pleasure. This pleasure either the young men copied from the older ones, or the older ones always kept. The grown people, like the children, looked with kindling eyes at all turmoil, expecting delight for themselves and for you. They were shocked only at disappointment. But boys and men, girls and ladies all, the old and the young of the Delta kin, even the dead and the living for Aunt Shannon, were alike. No gap open between them. Laura sat among them with her eyes wide. At any moment she might expose her ignorance. At any moment she might learn everything. All the Fairchilds in the Delta looked alike. Little Battle now, pushing his bobbed hair behind his ears before he took up a fresh drumstick, looked exactly like Dabney, the way she would think at the window. They all had a fleetness about them, though they were tall, solid people with Scotch legs. A neatness that was actually a readiness for gaieties and departures, a distraction that was endearing as a lack of burdens. Laura felt their quality, their being, in the degree that they were portentous to her. For Laura found them all portentous, all except Aunt Ellen, who had only married into the family. Uncle George more than Uncle Battle, for some reason. Dabney more than Shelley. Without a primary beauty, with only a fairness of color, a thin skinness, really, and an ease in the body, they had a demurring, gray-eyed way about them that turned out to be halfway mocking. For these cousins were the sensations of life, and they knew it. Why didn't Uncle George come on tonight, the best-loved? Why wasn't Dabney on time to supper, the bride? Things waited for them to appear, laughing to one another and amazed, in order to happen. They were forever, by luck or intuition, opening doors, discovering things, little or cherished things, running pell-mell down the stairs to meet people, ready to depart for vague and spontaneous occasions, though everything came to Shell Mound to them. All the girls got serenaded in the summertime, though Shelley last summer had said it pained her for Dabney to listen that way. They were never too busy for anything. They were generously and almost seriously of the moment. The past, even Laura's arrival today, was past now, was a private, dull matter that would be forgotten except by aunts. Laura, from her earliest memory, had heard how they never seemed to change at all. That was the way her mother, who had been away from them down in Jackson, where they would be hard to believe, could brag on them without seeming to. And yet Laura could see that they changed every moment. The outside didn't change, but the inside did. An iridescent life was busy within and under each a likeness. Laughter at something went over the table. Laura found herself with a picture in her mind of a great bower-like cage full of tropical birds her father had shown her in a zoo in a city. The sparkle of motion was like a rainbow, while it was the very thing that broke your heart. For the birds that flew were caged all the time and couldn't fly out. The Fairchild's movements were quick and on the instant, and that made you wonder, are they free? Laura was certain that they were compelled, their favorite word. Flying against the bad things happening, they kissed you in rushes of tenderness. Maybe their delight was part of their beauty, its flicker as it went by. and their kissing of not only you but everybody in a room was a kind of spectacle, an outward thing. But when they looked at you with their lighted eyes, picked you out in a room for a glance, waiting for you to say something in admiration or conceit, to ask the smallest favor of any of them you chose, and so to commit yourself forever, you could never question them again. You trusted them, that nothing more inward preoccupied them, for you adored them and only wanted to be here with them, to be let run toward them. They were all as sweet as Ranny, she thought. All sweet, right down to Ranny. Ranny being 4 and the youngest she could see at her end of the table, now angelically asleep in his chair with a little wishbone in his fist. Just as Roxy was about to clear the table, Dabney, gently but distractedly, came in, dressed in blue, drying tears from her eyes, and murmuring to her mother as she passed her chair, "Oh, Mama, that was just because my brain isn't working. Why did you bring up your children with faulty brains?"
"She ought to have drowned you when you were little," said Uncle Battle,
and this was their extravagant way of talk.
"Sit down. I saved you a wishbone and a heart, besides what poor pickings is left."
"Run some more biscuit in the oven, Roxy," Ellen said. "I think, too, you'd better bring Miss Dabney a little ham. There's such a dearth of turkey to tempt her."
"Say it again, Mama,"
said Ranny, opening his eyes. Then he smiled at Dabney.
"What were you crying about? The worry you're bringing down on your father?"
Battle said. Holding out her plate for her father to serve, she sat close by him, at his right. Dabney smiled, too, and waited. How beautiful she was, all flushed and knowing. Now they would tease her. An only child, Laura found teasing the thing she kept forgetting about the Delta cousins from one summer to the next. Uncle Battle might put the heart on Dabney's plate yet, knowing she couldn't bear to look at the heart, though Dabney would know what to do. Was it possible that it was because they loved one another so that it made them set little traps to catch one another? They looked with shining eyes upon their kin, and all their abundance of love, as if it were a devilment, was made reckless and inspired, or was belittled in fun, though never, so far, was it said out. They had never told Laura they loved her. She sighed. "Where's Aunt Primrose and Aunt Jim Allen?"
"Why don't you ask any questions about who's here?" said India.
"They said I had to come see them and tell them first," said Dabney, beginning to eat hungrily. "Touchy, touchy."
"I'm touchy, too," said Uncle Battle.
"Oh, Laura," cried Dabney delightedly. "I didn't know you'd got here. Why, honey." She flew around the table and kissed her. "I came to your wedding," said Laura, casting pleased, shy glances all around.
"Oh, Laura, you want me to marry Troy, don't you? You approve, don't you?"
"Yes," said Laura. "I approve, Dabney."
"You be in my wedding. You be a flower girl."
"I can't," said Laura helplessly.
"My mother died."
"Oh!" cried Dabney, as if Laura had slapped her, running away from her and back to her place at the table, hiding her face.
"It's just so hard. Everything's just so hard."
"Here's your little ham, Miss Dab," said Roxy, coming in. "Do you good."
"Oh, Roxy, even you. No one will ever believe me that I just can't swallow until Saturday. There's no use trying any more."
"You can bring the ice cream and cake then, Roxy," Aunt Ellen said. "It's Georgie's favorite cake. I do wish they could be here a day sooner." They sat sighing, eating cake, drinking coffee. The throb of the compress had never stopped. Laura could feel it now in the handle of her cup. The noiseless vibration that trembled in the best china was within it. It was hard to ever quite leave the dining room after supper. It would be still faintly day and not much cooler. They all still sat until the baby, who had hung teasing crumbs and coffee out of them from her high chair, "Mama, let Blewett eat at the table," wilted over like a little flower in her kimono with the butterfly sleeves, and was kissed all around and carried up in flushed sleep in Dabney's over-eager arms. The table was in the middle of the large room, and there was little tendency to leave even that. But besides the old walnut and cane chairs, great-grandfather made them, there were easy chairs covered with cotton in a faded peony pattern, and rockers for the two great aunts, sewing stands and fire shields beside them, all near the watery green tile hearth. A spready fern stood in front of the grate in summertime, with a cricket in it now that nobody could do anything about. Along the wall, the china closets reflected the windows, except for one visible shelf where some shell-pattern candlesticks shone, and the Port Gibson epergne, a fan of apostle spoons, and the silver sugar basket with the pierce work in it and its old, cracked, purplish glass lining. At the other end of the room, the victrola stood like a big morning glory, and there, laid with somebody's game, was the card table great-grandfather also made out of his walnut trees when he cut his way into the Yazoo wilderness. A long, ornate rattan settee, upslanting at the ends, with a steep, scrolled back, was in the bay alcove. In the half-moon of space behind it were marble pedestals and wicker stands, each holding a fern of advanced size, or a little rooted cutting, sometimes in bloom. Overhead, over the loaded plate rails, were square oil paintings of split melons and cut flowers by Aunt Mishula as a young girl. This evening there was nobody but Uncle Battle to take Cherry Bounce, and hating anything alone, he wouldn't have it, but with a groan sat down and took Blewett's doll out of his chair onto his knee. Dabney wandered in, Aunt Ellen wandered out. Mary Lamar Mackey wandered across the hall into the music room and began to play softly to herself. But nobody else, Great Aunt Mac or anybody, could be persuaded to stir. Maureen, gentle now, sat on a stool and listened for the cricket. In a little while, Dabney and Shelley and Mary Lamar would have to go dress for a dance in Glen Allen, but now the two sisters stretched on the settee, each with her head at an elevated end and her stockinged feet in her sister's hair. Catching the light like drops of a waterfall, the fronds of a maidenhair fern hung from a dark tub over them. Fan us, India, said Dabney, though the big overhead fan turned, too. Ranny will fan you before he goes to bed, India said, and Ranny came radiantly forward with Great Aunt Shannon's palmetto.
Oh, said Dabney, you'd think I had nothing to do. I wonder if Troy is in from the fields.
There's one speck of light left, said Shelley. Cousin Laura, said Orin kindly, looking up from his book at her. He leaned on the table.
You weren't here, but Uncle George and Maureen nearly got killed.
Uncle George?
Laura alone had not reclined. She stood looking into the big mirror over the sideboard, which reflected the whole roomful of cousins.
Ranny, you fanned too hard.
They nearly let the yellow dog run over them on the Dry Creek trestle.
Dabney softly laughed from her prone position. India moaned from the chair she was leaning over to read a book on the floor.
It was almost a tragedy, said Shelley. She lifted up her head, then let it fall back. Why did they let the yellow dog almost run over them? Laura made her way to the table and leaned on it to ask Orin, who answered her gravely with his finger in his place in the book. Here's the way it was. For all of them told happenings like narrations, chronological and careful, as if the ear of the world listened and wished to know surely. The whole family but Papa and Mama and 10 or 20 Negroes with us went fishing in Drowning Lake. It will be 2 weeks ago Sunday. And so coming home, we walked the track. We were tired. We were singing. On the trestle, Marine danced and caught her foot. I've done that, but I know how to get loose. Uncle George kneeled down and went to work on Maureen's foot, and the train came. He hadn't got Maureen's foot loose, so he didn't jump either. The rest of us did jump, and the dog stopped just before it hit them and ground them all to pieces. Uncle Battle looked at Dabney with a kind of outraged puffing of his sunburned cheeks, a glare in her direction like some fatherly malediction. Whether it was meant for Dabney herself in front of his eyes, or for what he had heard, Laura couldn't tell. And as if glaring itself made him nervous, he dandled the ragged doll heavily on his knee. Dabney gave a half smile. The engineer looked out the window. He said he was sorry. Laura looked at her gravely. I'm glad I wasn't there, she told her. Then Aunt Ellen came in, meditatively, as the hall clock finished striking 2, which meant it was 8. She had a feather on her skirt. Had she been out for her precious guinea eggs? She was a slight, almost delicate lady, seeming exactly strong enough for what was needed of her life. She was scarcely taller than Orin, and Dabney and Shelley had been both taller and bigger than their mother for 2 years. She walked into the room full of family without immediately telling them anything. She was more restful than the Fairchilds. Her brown hair and her dark blue eyes seemed part of her quietness, like the colors of water, reflective. Her Virginia voice, while no softer or lighter than theirs, was a less questioning, a never teasing one. It was a voice to speak to the one child or the one man her eyes would go to. They all watched her with soft eyes, but distractedly. She was one of those little mothers that the wind seems almost to hurt, and they knew they needed to look after her. She held very straight in her back, like a little boy who can do right in dancing class. And while she meditated, she hurried. How she hurried! She was never slow. She was either still or darting. They said she had no need for hurry with a house full of Negroes to do the first thing she told them, but she didn't wait for them or anybody to wait on her. Your mother is killing herself, Battle's sisters told the children. But you can't do a thing in the world with her, they answered. We're going to have to whip her or kill her before she'll lie down in the afternoons, even. They spoke of killing and whipping in the exasperation and helplessness of much love. Laura could see as far as that she was the opposite of a Fairchild, and that was a stopping point. Aunt Ellen would be seen busy in a room where Aunt Tempy, for instance, was never seen except proceeding down halls or seated. She never cared how she dressed any more than a child. Aunt Tempy said to India last summer, in the voice in which she always spoke to little girls, as if everything were a severe revelation, "When your mother goes to Greenwood, she simply goes to the closet and says, 'Clothes, I'm going to Greenwood. Anything that wants to go along, get on my back.'
She has never learned what is reprehensible and what is not in the Delta.
She was often a little confused about her keys, and sometimes would ask Dabney, "What was I going for? Why am I here?" When she threw her head back dramatically, it meant she was listening for a baby. Her small, sweetly shaped nose was sparingly freckled, like a little girl's, like India's in summer. Sometimes, as when now she stood still for a moment in the room full of talking people, an unaccountable rosiness would jump into her cheeks, and a look of merriment would make her eyes grow wide. Down low over the dinner table hung a lamp with a rectangular shade of tinted glass, like a lighted shoebox toy, a choo-choo boat, with its colored paper windows. In its light she would look over the room, at the youngest ones intertwining on the rug and hating so the approach of night, the older ones leaning across the cleared table, chasing each other in a circle, or reading, or lost to themselves on the flimsy settee, Battle pondering in his way or fuming, while from time to time the voices of the girls called out to the telephone would sound somewhere in the air like the twittering of birds. And it would be as if she had never before seen anything at all of this room with the big breasting china closets and the fruit and cake plates around the rail, had never watered the plants in the window, or encountered till now these absorbed, intent people. Ever before in her life, Laura thought. At that moment, a whisper might have said, "Look," to her, and the dining room curtains might have traveled back on their rings, and there they were. Even some unused love seemed to Laura to be in Aunt Ellen's eyes when she gazed after supper at her own family. Could she get it? Laura's heart pounded. But the baby had dreams, and soon she would cry out on the upper floor, and Aunt Ellen, listening, would run straight to her, calling to her on the way, and forgetting everything in this room. How Ellen loved their wide and towering foreheads, their hairlines on the fresh skin, silver as the edge of a peach, clean as a pencil line, dipping to a perfect widow's peak in every child she had. Their cheeks were wide and their chins narrow, but pressed a little forward, lips caught, then parted, as if in constant expectation, so that their faces looked sturdy and resolute, unrevealing from the side, but tender and heart-shaped from the front. Their coloring, their fair hair and their soot-dark high eyebrows and shadowy lashes, the long eyes of gray that seemed more luminous, more observant, and more passionate than blue, moved her deeply and freshly in each child. Dear Orin, talking so seriously now, the dignity in his look, and little Ranny with his burning cheeks and the silver bleach of summer on his hair, so deliberately wielding the fan over his sisters. She had never had a child to take after herself, and would be as astonished as Battle now to see her own ways or looks dominant, a blue-eyed, dark-haired, small-boned baby lying in her arms. All the mystery of looks moved her, for she was with child once more. In the men grown, in Battle and George, it was a paradoxical thing, the fineness and tenderness with the bulk and weight of their big bodies. All the Fairchild men, the old maid's sister, Jim Allen, would recite that like a bit of catechism, were 6 feet tall by the time they were 16 and weighed 200 pounds by the time they were 40. But Battle weighed 250. And grown to be gentle as he was. And George, though he was not himself fat, was markedly bigger and fairer than any of them in the early portraits, as if he were not a throwback to the type, which had faltered but little, after all, through marriages with little women like her, like Laura Allen and Mary Shannon before her. but a new original, a sport of the tree itself. She guessed she apprehended everything through the way they looked and felt. George sometimes more than Battle. Battle wore the glower of fatherhood, or its little undermask of helplessness, that George hadn't put on. And George had remained left-handed, the thing they all inherited, as was somehow visibly apparent, not just momently, but always, perhaps by such a thing as the part in his hair. Her secret tremor at Battle's determined breaking of her children's left-handedness made her cherish it like a failing in George. The fineness in her men called to mind their unwieldiness, and the other way around, in a way infinitely endearing to her. The fineness could so soon look delicate. Nobody could get tireder, fall sicker, and more quickly so than her men. She thought yet of the other brother, Dennis, who was dead in France, as holding this look. From the grave he gave her that look, partly of hurt. How could I have been brought like this? As Battle cried in the far field when his horse, unaccountably terrified at the old yellow dog one day, threw him and left him unable to raise himself from the ditch. Oh, it was cloudy, or we would have remembered it was time for the dog, Aaron was saying, looking up from his book. We wouldn't have made that mistake another day, when we could see the sun. The dog was most likely running an hour late, and it wouldn't have done us any good, Dabney smiled. She twisted her foot in Shelley's hair, where they were lying together on the settee. I'm making a hole in your net with my big toe. I won't lie here with you any longer, Shelley said languidly. But she did not move or close her eyes fully. She looked rather dreamily down the slope of her own body, midi blouse, skirt, dark blue stockings, and up Dabney's, light blue stockings, light blue Swiss dress with one lace panel momently floating in Ranny's breeze, and Dabney's just-washed hair a-flying on her clasped hands behind her head. Dabney's face was suffused and soft now as Bluett's when she was waked from her nap. Her eyes seemed to swim in some essence, not tears, but as bright, an essence that made the pupils large. The sisters looked now into each other's eyes, and as if there was no help for it, a flare leaped between them. There was a lusty cry from Maureen. She's caught the cricket! She's pulling his wings off! She'll kill the cricket! Roy was on his feet.
Don't stop her! Don't stop her! Let her have her way! Battle said, his voice rumbling in Ellen's ears.
The cricket minded, I think, Ranny said, holding the fan still.
Come help me make a cake before bedtime, Laura, said Ellen. Now she saw Laura with forgetful eyes fastened on her. She's the poor little old thing, she thought. When a man alone has to look after a little girl, how in even 8 months she will get long-legged and skinny. She will, as like as not, need to have glasses when school starts. He doesn't cut her hair, or he will cut it too short. How sharp her elbows are! Maureen looks like a cherub beside her. The difference just in their elbows.
I'll be glad to, Aunt Ellen, Laura said, and put her hand in hers as if she were Ranny's age. She came along in a toiling little walk.
Get out of the kitchen, Roxy. We want to make Mr. George and Miss Robbie a cake. They're coming tomorrow.
You loves them, said Roxy. You're fixing to ask me to grate you a coconut, not get out.
Yes, I am. Grate me the coconut, Ellen smiled. I got 14 guinea eggs this evening, and that's a sign I ought to make it, Roxy.
Take 'em all, guineas, said Roxy belittlingly.
Well, you get the oven hot. Ellen tied her apron back on. You can grate me the coconut and a lemon while you're at it, and blanch me the almonds. I'm going to let Laura pound me the almonds in the mortar and pestle.
Is that very hard? Asked Laura, running out for a drink at the water cooler.
Ellen was breaking and separating the 14 eggs. Yes, I do want coconut, she murmured. For Ellen's hope for Dabney, that had to lie in something, some secret nest, lay in George's happiness. He had married beneath him, too, in Tempe's unvarying word. When he got home from the war, he married, in the middle of one spring night, little Robbie Reed, old man Swanson's granddaughter, who had grown up in the town of Fairchilds to work in Fairchild's store. She beat the egg whites and began creaming the sugar and butter, and saying a word from time to time to Laura, who hung on the table and watched her. She felt busily consoled for the loss of Dabney to Troy Flavin by the happiness of George lost to Robbie. She remembered, as if she vigorously worked the memory up out of the mixture, a picnic at the Grove, the old place, an exuberant night in the spring before. It wasn't long after the death of Annie Laurie down in Jackson. Robbie had tantalizingly let herself be chased and had jumped in the river with George in after her, everybody screaming from where they lay. Dalliance, pure play George was, after that night. He was enchanted with his wife. He made it plain then. They were in moonlight. With great splashing, he took her dress and petticoat off in the water, flung them out on the willow bushes, and carried her up screaming in her very teddies, her lost ribbon in his teeth, and the shining water running down her kicking legs and flying off her heels as she screamed and buried her face in his chest, laughing too, proud too. The sisters, Jim Allen's and Primrose's garden ran right down to the water there. How could they have known their brother George would someday carry a dripping girl out of the river and fling her down thrashing and laughing on a bed of their darling sweet peas, pulling vines and all down on her? George flung himself down by her, too, and threw his wet arm out and drew her on to his fast-breathing chest. They lay there, smiling and worn out, but twined together, appealing, shining in moonlight, and almost, somehow, threatening, Ellen felt. They were so boldly happy, with Dabney and Shelley there, with Primrose and Jim Allen trembling for their sweet peas, if not daring to think of George's life risked, and India seizing the opportunity of running up and sprinkling them with pomegranate flowers and handfuls of grass to tickle them. Dabney had brought young Dicky Boy Featherstone along that night. They had sat timidly holding hands on the river bank, Dabney with a clover chain circling and festooning her like a net. They had chided Robbie. She had endangered George. He couldn't swim well for a wound of war. But no one can stare back more languorously and alluringly than a rescued woman, Ellen believed, from the memory of Robbie's slumberous eyes and surfeited little smile as she lay on George's wet arm. George was delighted, as by some passing transformation in her, speaking some word to her and making her look away toward them, overcome with merriment. As if she had beguiled him in some obvious way he found absurd and endearing. As if she had tried to arouse his jealousy, for instance, by flirting with another man. As Ellen put in the nutmeg and the grated lemon rind, she diligently assumed George's happiness, seeing it in the Fairchild aspects of exuberance and satiety. If it was unabashed, it was the best part true. But, adding the milk, the egg whites, the flour, carefully and alternately,
as Mashula's recipe said. She could be diligent, and still not wholly sure, never wholly. She loved George too dearly herself to seek her knowledge of him through the family attitude, keen and subtle as that was, just as she loved Dabney too much to see her prospect without its risk, now family deplored around it, the happiness covered with danger. "Look who Robbie Reed is," they had said once, and now, "Who is Troy Flavin?" Indeed, who was Troy Flavin, beyond being the Fairchild overseer? Nobody knew, only that he had a little mother in the hills. It was killing Battle. She heard him now calling, "Dabney! Dabney! Dickie Boy Featherstone's blowing his horn!" And at the telephone, Dabney was talking softly to Troy. "I'm with Dickie Boy Featherstone, gone to Glen Allen. Good night. Good night." It seemed to Ellen that it was for every one of them that added care pressed her heart on these late summer nights. "Now you can taste, Laura," she said. Care that stirred in her and that she herself shielded, like the child she carried. "Now, Laura, go get that little bottle of rose water off the top shelf in the pantry. Climb where Roy climbs for the cookie jar, and you'll reach it. Now be putting in a little rose water as you go. Pound good." She poured her cake out in 4-layer pans and set the first two in the oven, gently shutting the door. "Be ready, Laura, when I call you. Oh, save me 24 perfect halves to go on top." She began with the rest of the eggs to make the filling. She would just trust that Laura's paste would do, and make the icing thick on top with the perfect almonds over it close enough to touch. "Smell my cake?" she challenged, as Dabney appeared radiant at the pantry door, then coming through, spreading her pink dress to let her mother see her. Ellen turned a little dizzily. Was the cake going to turn out all right? She was always nervous about her cakes. And for George, she did want it to be nice. He was so appreciative. "Don't pound your poor finger, Laura."
"I wasn't going to, Aunt Ellen."
"Oh, Mother, am I beautiful? Tonight?" Dabney asked urgently, almost painfully, as though she would run if she heard the answer. Laura laid down the noisy pestle. Her lips...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.